It's our pleasure this afternoon to chair this special session to welcome Professor Kawamura from Japan. Professor Kawamura is a director and associate professor of reproduction and infertility center at the St. Mariana University School of Medicine that's just outside Tokyo. And recently, he has established an in vitro activation method to treat infertility in patients with primary ovarian insufficiency and has achieved many successful pregnancies and deliveries. And for those of you from the United States who attend the meeting in Chicago for the last few years, Dr. Aaron Shrey from Stanford has been presenting this data a number of times, and it's very nice to now finally meet the man who edits the work in Japan.
Well, thank you for your kind introduction. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizing committee for inviting me to be here. Today, I'd like to talk about IVA, in vitro activation, a new infertility treatment for patients with a primary ovarian insufficiency. Okay, this is the contents of today's talk. For in the background POI, I'm going to talk about our basic and translational studies for IVA, and then we'll talk about its clinical application, and also I'd like to talk about future studies of IVA. So let's start with the background POI. The POI, also called as a premature ovarian failure, POF, diagnosed by amenorrhea before 40 years of age, and hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. And a patient showed infertility and symptoms caused by estrogen deficiency, such as the hot flashes. Oops. With disturbances, sexual dysfunction, etc. And a specific feature of the POI are lack of follicle growth and ovulation, and exhaustion of ovarian follicles. And patients have few residual follicles, should be less than 1,000 follicles. That's why if we try to measure the MH levels, almost all the patients showed undetectable levels. Because of these specific features, patients are really resistant to traditional gonadotropin treatments, and egg donation is the most successful option, treatment option, but you know, patients likely to conceive using their own eggs. So now I'm going to talk about basic and translational studies for IVA. The primordial follicle is dormant in ovaries, and some growth factors, such as kid ligand, neurotropins, BMPs, VGF, LIF, have demonstrated to activate primordial to be a primary stage. However, among a huge number of the dormant follicles, up to 0.1% follicles are selected to activate per cycle. So because POI has less than 1,000 residual follicles, theoretically, these growth factors can activate only one follicle per cycle. So almost impossible to use these growth factors for the clinical setting. So we forget about this ligand receptor reactions. We focus on an intracellular signaling system involved in the activation of the primordial follicles. So based on the knockout mouse studies, Brady and Casridon reported a similar phenotype in PTEN knockout and FOX3 knockout mice. So left panel indicates wild type and right panel indicates PTEN knockout. So here you can see there is no difference between wild type and PTEN knockout at day 5 after birth. But at day 13.5 after birth, in the wild type, the ovary have some growing follicles, but in PTEN knockout, ovary totally became bigger, and you can see multiple growing follicles inside. It's really originating from the spontaneous activation of primordial follicles. And at 16 weeks after birth, of course, in the wild-type mice, there is some still follicular activity, but in a PTEN knockout, almost all the follicles depleted. And only the follicular size became very small and looks like POI phenotype ovary. And completely similar phenotype could be obtained from the Peter knockout here, FOX3 knockout. And this similar phenotype could be explained by the PI3K signaling pathway. The PI3K signaling pathway begins the PI3K activation by receptor tyrosine kinases binding the growth factors. And then PI3K activates AKT, which inhibit the activity of FOX3, resulting in cell proliferation and survival. And P10, this one, negatively regulating the PI3K signaling pathway. So in primordial follicles, local factors activate dormant follicles through this PI3K, AKT, FOX3 signaling pathway, where the P10 actually blocks the signaling. Because it's really difficult to do the genetic therapy in a human, so we have said, is it possible to activate residual dormant follicles in a pure patient artificially by transient P10 suppression and or PI3K activation using some drugs? Now we have a P10 inhibitor, a vanadidyl complex hydroxycholinic acid, very long name, the highly potent and a specific inhibitor at nanomolar concentration. And also we have a PI3K activator, a cell-permeable phosphopeptide, the name is 740YP, which binds to the SH2 domain of the P85 regulatory subunit of a PI3K, and then activate its enzymatic activity. So, using these reagents, we performed an animal study to assess our hypothesis. So we use day three mice that only consists of the primordial follicles, then divided into two groups. One is a control, the other is P10 inhibitor and PI3K activator group. And after 2 days culture, we transplanted these ovaries into the chironin capsule of adult ovariectomized mice. The ovariectomization was performed to increase an endogenous FSH level to further support the follicular growth after activation of the dormant follicles. And I think it's already good enough, but for just guaranteeing, we treated animals with an FSH. And finally, we treated animals with an HCG to obtain a mature oocyte and performed the IVFET to obtain an offspring. So this slide shows the changes in ovarian size at day 14 after transplantation. So here you can see the treatment of the P10 inhibitor, ovary became bigger, and PI3K activator treatment, ovary also became bigger. And if we try to use both P10 inhibitor and PI3K activator, it showed a synergistic effect. So then we performed the histological analysis to evaluate the follicular dynamics at day 14 after the transplantation of ovaries. So gray column indicated control, the black column indicated drug treatment. So as we expected, the proportion of primordial follicles was decreased by drug treatment. However, and the proportion of primary, pre-antral, antral, even a large antral follicles, all increased by drug treatment. So then we try to evaluate the normality of the oocyte obtained from the ovary with drug treatment. The meiotic spindle formation was evaluated by beta tubulin staining here, whereas the integrity of the dynamic imprinting was confirmed by detecting the mesuration of the CPD site in differentially mesurated region, the name DMR region, of some imprinting genes. So here you can see all the oocytes show the normal spindle formation obtained from the ovaries with drug treatment. And also T indicates a drug treatment, C indicates a control. And you can see there is no difference in the maturation of CPG site in maternally imprinting the IGF2R and also LIT1 and paternally imprinting the H19. So then we performed IVFET to further confirm the normality of the oocyte obtained after IVA. So here you can see the oocyte could fertilize and could develop to the blastocyst stage. And after embryo transfer, we could get a completely healthy pups. And after our publication, the Sweden group also repeated our studies and confirmed the healthiness of the pups more detail. And then I moved on the translational study using the human ovarian cortex. And we performed the xenotransplantation of the human ovarian fragment to activate the dormant follicles. Here we got a human ovarian cortical fragment from the benign ovarian tumor with informed consent, of course, IRB approval, and then divided into two groups. One is a control, the other is a PT inhibitor treatment. So at that time, we just used a PT inhibitor, but later on, we confirmed both PT inhibitor and a PI3K activator treatment was more effective. And then after 2 days culture, we then transplanted in, these ovaries are then transplanted into the kinurin capsule of overreactive mice, skid mice. Skid mice was used to avoid a rejection between human and mice, and also we performed overreactivization to increase an endogenous FSH levels. So important thing is that in the human, it takes almost 6 months from primordial to the preoperative stage, so we treated animals with an FSH for 6 months. And then eventually we gave an HCG to try to obtain a mature human oocyte. So this picture is a morphology of the human ovarian fragments after 6 months of xenotransplantation. So here is the inside of body. As I always put the one side of the control, the other side of PT inhibitor to avoid the difference in among the animals. And then these are dissected kidneys with grafted ovaries. So here you can see in the control group, the grafted ovary is very small, but in PT inhibitor group, you can see the large grafted ovary with multiple growing antrum follicle. And this slide shows the histology of the PT inhibitor treated ovarian fragments. This is at 30 hours after the HG treatment. So here's a kidney and a follicle grown to the kidney, and you can see this cumulus oocyte complex is almost ovulating, and we're showing a first polar body exclusion. That means a mature M2 stage oocyte. And this, she or she is still attached to the follicular wall, but showing a cumulus expansion in response to the FSH, HCG stimulation. So based on the success of these animal studies, we also performed the monkey study to confirm the safety of this approach, and then move on the clinical application. So this is a scheme for the clinical application of IVA. The first step is ovariectomy under laparoscopic surgery, and then we can go to the in vitro activation step, or we can prepare the ovarian cortical stripes for freezing. And we are now using a vitrification method for cryopreservation. And then during cryopreservation, we can perform the histological analysis to detect the residual follicles and ovaries. And then after IVA culture, we transplant the activated ovarian cubes using the laparoscope surgery again. Then we can do the regular IVF. So we got the IRB approval from Human Subject Committee of from our university and also the Japan Society of OBGYN. And when we summarized the second paper, we published in a, we enrolled 83 POI patients. The average age is 37.4, and their duration of amenorrhea was 5.7 years. Okay, from now on, I'm going to talk about details of a method. And the first step is, as I said, ovariectomy under laparoscopic surgery. And the important part, things is we try to minimize the usage of the electrical capillary homeostasis to avoid the damage of residual follicles in the ovary. Indeed, the POI ovary has very few blood circulation. So that's why we can really minimize the usage of the electrical capillary homeostasis during the surgery. And this picture shows the localization of ovary follicles in the ovarian cortex. This is not human, unfortunately, but this is a cat ovary, but construction is completely the same as a human. So here you can see the early follicles. Early means the primordial, primary, and early secondary follicles are located within a 1 to 2 meter thickness from the surface of the ovarian cortex. And large antral follicles always located in the deeper part, the medulla of the ovaries. So we dissected cortices containing residual follicles by removing medulla like this way and cut into the small stripes, 1 centimeter square with 1 to 2 meter thickness where residual follicles are located. And here we can, of course, cryopreserve these ovarian species by vitrification method. And usually from one POI ovary, we could obtain 6 to 8 pieces of ovarian stripes, like this way. And after that, we always do in a histological analysis using a 10% volume of each ovarian stripes to detect the residual follicles. So final predictive factors for presence of residual follicles. We analyze the correlation between the histological data and the duration of amenorrhea, age for onset of amenorrhea, and ovary size, and found the best predictive factor is the duration of amenorrhea. So maybe up to 4 years of amenorrhea, the patient's likely to have a residual follicles. And then next step is a fragmentation of 2 to 3 ovarian pieces into tiny ovarian cubes and treated with an IVA drugs, a PTE inhibitor and a PI3K activator for 2 days to activate the dormant follicles. So now I'm cutting ovarian pieces into these tiny ovarian cubes and put on the membrane of the cell culture insert and covered by the very thin layer of the media to allow the tissue culture. And after culture, before transplantation, we wash and culture the ovarian cubes by warm culture media alone to avoid introducing a reagent inside the body. And we transplanted these ovarian cubes beneath the serosa of the fallopian tubes. We can transfer the 20 to 40 cubes per site. I will explain later. And why we chose that beneath of the serosa of the fallopian tube? Because of its high vascularization and a convenience for the transplant and ultrasound monitoring and is for the oocyte retrieval. These pictures for the transplantation number and cubes. The first, I cut the serosa and making a pouch between serosa and the fallopian tube, and then graft multiple ovarian cubes beneath the serosa of the fallopian tube, like this way. And then the wound was covered by the intercept, or of course we can make a suture to avoid a cube loss from the graft site. So this is a movie for transplantation. Here's a cutting site. And the white one is activated ovarian cubes. Using these Marian forceps, we can put back individually like this way. Well, that looks very easy, but if you try to do it, not so easy. So that's why I developed a new device like this plunger type. And you can insert 10 to 15 ovarian cubes here and push this device from the incision of the serosa of the fallopian tube, then push out all the ovarian cubes. But the problem is that these ovarian cubes accumulated in each other, and that's why we need to spread out after pushing out and try to avoid ischemic damage inside of this clot. And after grafting, we monitor the follicle growth weekly to biweekly and under the transvaginal ultrasound monitoring and measurement of the serum estrogen and gonadotropin levels. The most important tip is maintain our LH level to be normal range using the, of course, estrogen supplementation, and also we can use an androgen agonist. Whatever. When estrogen levels were increased, and follicle growth was promoted by recombinant FSH, and or the HMG, and the GnRH or the antagonist protocols. And finally, after the FGG treatment, OSAB retrieval followed by IVF was performed. So among 83 patients, ovary grafting was performed 46 patients, and follicular growth was found in 28 of 46 patients, almost more than half, containing resident follicles based on the histological analysis. And of note, no follicle growth was observed in patients without residual follicles by our histological analysis. And after IVF, embryos were cryopreserved at day 2. And the thawing embryo transfer was performed in patients when we summarized the second paper, and others were accumulating in cryopreserved embryos. So 3 of the 8 patients became pregnant after an embryo transfer. Unfortunately, one was a miscarriage, but we could get 2 successful deliveries. So this is the first baby in the world after an IVA. Because I did C-section by myself, I'm holding this baby. And now he is already more than 3 years old. And the mother, of course, healthy, and he himself is very healthy. And the reproducibility of IVA was already confirmed by China and a Spain group the previous lecture, Professor Antonio Persia mentioned about this. And they succeeded on pregnancy and delivery. And this is a picture showing a press conference in China in last May. He is describing they succeeded the first clinical pregnancy after IVA. Now the baby was born and she was very healthy. And this slide shows the temporal follicle growth in transplanted ovaries. Because it takes around 6 months from primordial to pre-ovary stage in human, so first of all, I expected to obtain a follicular growth after 6 months of the grafting. But in some patients, the follicular growth could be obtained even within several months. So that means the IVA method also stimulated the growth of the secondary follicles in the grafted ovaries. So, unfortunately, due to the shortage of time of presentation, I will not be able to go into detail, but here I summarize why the fragmentation can promote the secondary follicles. The ovarian fragmentation always led to the changing in intracellular tension, and then globular action facilitated to the conversion of the filamentous action. And this filamentous action suppressed the Hippo signaling pathway, and then allowed to YAP go into a nuclei and produce an CCN growth factors, and also the neovascularization factors, anti-apoptotic factors, all contribute to the secondary follicular growth. So here I'm going to talk about the future studies of IVA. So now you know the IVA requires a 2 times the laparoscopic surgery. So I'd like to develop a less invasive approach using the intake or injection. Maybe injection will be better. Injection to the directly to the ovary under the transvaginal ultrasound. And the reagent for the disruption of Hippo signaling pathway. And also, the IVA cannot apply the patients without residual follicles, of course. To save this patient, we have to do the regeneration oocyte, maybe from the iPS cell or OSA precursor and or stem cells. So to develop a less invasive approach, I'm thinking to intake or injection of reagent for disrupting the Hippo signaling pathway. And although this approach cannot apply for the severe POI patient without secondary follicles, only have the primordial follicles. But we can treat a patient with a DOR, diminishing ovarian reserve, or not so severe POI patients. And we already found out the candidate molecule. The name is a sphingosine 1 phosphate, S1P. So S1P is a bioactive sphingosine repeat acting on the GPCR to suppress the hypoxemia pathway. And the important thing is that S1P is a physiological substance and exists in follicular fluid in the ovaries. So using a data mass ovarian tissue culture system, we confirmed this S1P stimulating a nuclear translocation in the YAP in granular cell, and followed by the increase of the expression of downstream CCN2 growth factors. And also S1P increased in ovarian weight, and ovary became bigger, and stimulated a secondary follicular growth. So we also tested a human ovarian cortex and containing early secondary follicles at 3 hours after the S1P treatment. S1P increase in expression of CCN2 growth factor, even in human ovary. So we demonstrated S1P disruption, hypoxemia in early follicles, leading to stimulation of secondary follicle growth. So as I said, because S1P is a physiological substance existing in follicular fluid, I expect to injection S1P to the directly to the ovary and stimulate the follicular growth in POIDOR patients, including the aging, without severe adverse reactions. So let's move on to the last topic. So in 2013, also the people attending this meeting knows, and Dr. Tilly in used to be at Harvard, succeeded to regenerate an ulcer from Ogonia stem cells. This is a method for isolation of Ogonia stem cells by Tilly, and he got a frozen human ovarian cortex obtained from a Japanese patient, and these ovarian tissues are dispersed by treatment with a collagenase. The forerunner, and using the cell sorter, his group performed the FACS isolation of Ogonia stem cell using DDX4 antibody and the culture for 1 month, and then succeeded regenerating a human oocyte. But unfortunately, it's really difficult to repeat. We could not do it. We could not repeat it. So we tried to develop a new method to regenerate an oocyte. In contrast to the Tilly's method, we focus on the medulla because we do the IVA, so usually we just remove the medulla, and also the medulla is a part, where the part of the first wave of the primordial follicle formation when during the fetal stage. And then except the isolation of the DDX4 antibody step, we dispersed the ovarian medulla tissues by collagenase and the culture with a 10% FBS for 1 month. And then we could get the oocyte-like cells. The diameter was more than 30 micrometer in and after culture. But these cells are just looks like oocyte. And of course, didn't complete any meiosis. So this slide shows the gene expression changing during human oogenesis. So at primordial germ cell stage, the cells express in PRDM1, and once enter meiosis, start to express a DASO, and after that, SYCP3, and finally express in SYCP1. So using these genetic markers, so we try to develop a new method to induce a meiosis in the obtain the cells from the medulla. So, and the cortex and the PRDM cells are already existing based on the Tilly's paper, but in a method, we couldn't find any PRDM positive cells in medulla tissues, maybe no contamination. And but after, at 3 hours after cell dispersion, tissue dispersion, we could get the PRDM positive cells here. That a little hard to see, but the red one is a PRDM positive cell, and suggests that tissue dispersion could differentiate in the PRDM positive cells from the medulla. And then we checked the self ability for the self replication, using a one-cell culture system. We tested it and using the tears media, and sorry, it's located the wrong way. But anyway, they could show the self-replication ability. And the doubling time was 2.5 days. Then we tried to induce a meiotic-related genes during the culture in PRDM1-positive cells. We followed the TDS method using this reagent, but unfortunately, we could not induce a DASO expression. So then we applied the method for regeneration also from ES cells. My friend in Japan, his name is Hayashi, who succeeded regenerated all cell and sperm from iPS and ES cells in mice. So we discussed with him and we tried to apply this method. And then we could get the DASU expression. So instead of FBS, we used a KSL, and also adding a BMP4, it was more efficient to induce a DASU expression. But again, unfortunately, we could not induce an SYCP expression using retinoic acid. Then we tried to predict the important factors for meiosis based on the microanalysis of murine female germline cells. So this is our strategy. Upregulated genes, more than two-fold, were extracted from the microRNA data by comparison of those in 11.5 DPC and 30.5 DPC. And then identify the transcriptional factors related to the upregulated genes here, and then predict the upstream signals based on the transcriptional factors. And from upregulated genes, we could find the translational factors from A to D. And then we could predict the upstream signals based on the published data set and papers, A to D. And then using the agonists or the ligands of signal A to D, eventually we could succeed to induce an SYCP expression. Now SYCP is located in the nuclei, working on the other transcriptional factor. So now we are trying to confirm the last step of the meiosis showing the expression of SYCP1. And what I want to emphasize is the PRDM1-positive cells could obtain the medullary tissue of normal and ovaries, and also the POI, even in the POI ovaries, in all cases, including the patients without residual follicles. And our method could induce meiosis in these cells. Yeah, so this is our team, IVA team, and I'd like to thank especially Aaron Shue in Stanford. We have long collaboration with an IVA, especially he took part of the basic study of the IVA. Thank you for your kind attention.
Are there any burning questions? We may have time just for one or two, but maybe I can just ask you a very quick question. You mentioned that Spain and China have replicated your work. How many attempts were done before you were successful?
In China and the Spain group? China group, I think less than 10 patients, yeah. And Spain EB group, I don't know exactly, but should be less than 10, I think, for the first cases.
Yeah, I always admired your work, and even without my hearing aids, your English was so perfect that I could understand you very well. But, you know, the question I have is, it seems like when we just take off the ovarian cortex and cut it into pieces and put it back, that maybe that alone suppresses HIPPO and P10. So for clinical, practical purposes, do you think we have to perform the in vitro activation, or could just the autotransplantation be enough for these POI patients?
Thank you for your question. And this is always asking, and my opinion is what I can prove is Because in our lab basic study history, first we realized that using the PI3K activators can activate the dormant follicle. But theoretically, the follicular growth could be obtained after 6 months. And then we realized that something occurred in before the 6 months after grafting. Then discovered the hypocinin disruption. And also, after discovery in the clinical trial, we always taking one ovary and the other side ovary just cutting. Okay? And some of them are already quite preserved, and to see that whether the cut ovary with cutting can grow, stimulate follicular growth in pure patient. But we do always a histology, and because if the patient has secondary follicles, the patient likely to have a follicular growth, even just cutting. But if the patients only have the primordial follicles, never responded just cutting. So that could be proof that, activation of the primordial follicles using reagent is important for the patient who has only primordial follicles or residual follicles. Yes.
Thank you, Charles TB from Paris. Congratulations, it's very amazing what you have done. Can you imagine that for the first surgery, you don't make a total ovariectomy, and you keep the ovary, you just remove one part of the ovary, and find the cells and make the patent manipulation, and then put back in an orthotopic situation in the ovary, the pieces of ovary. What do you think about that?
Well, yeah, actually,
because maybe that would be spontaneous pregnancy.
Yes. Yeah. Actually, the EB group doing such way, and the Spain group doing such way, and also we already started such kind of clinical studies. But one thing we have to realize is that approach can be maybe used only, patient with patients who have high number of the residual follicles, because we now remove the one entirely whole ovary and do the histology. And maybe, as I explained, usually we could get 6 to 8 pieces from one PI ovary. And after the histology, not all the pieces could have the residual follicle. The distribution is really heterogeneous, like a spot. So that means that we can find out which pieces could have a residual follicles. Of course, after histology, the part is already fixed and cannot use in a transplantation, but maybe we can predict somehow if we compare the without no information. So that's why that approach could be done if the patient has high number of residual follicles, and if the patient has very low, limited number of residual follicles, I think we'd better to do the removal of the entire whole ovary.
Okay, we have to move on to the next session.
Thank you.